anemia.
Thank you. Despite the glitches, I think we are on the track, and I'm also happy to be with the audience. I'm always worried to be the first to speak, but by default, we are delayed. So I'm really happy for that, a selfish reason. So this topic is going to be anemia, which is a purely for the sake of practitioners. And it's a very simple topic, not a very high-paying topic in robotics, laparoscopy. You know, we had a lot of high technical talks in the past. So anemia, first to say, previous step. See, by itself is not, next. By itself is not a diagnosis, it's a finding. So, So we have to really investigate the cause of the anemia. Unless you know the etiology or what's the type of anemia, you won't be able to give the correct treatment. So I will, the next few minutes, I will take you step by step to see how you work out the case of anemia so that you'll be able to arrive at a diagnosis. Next. So this is just an introduction where the primitive stem cell gives to various lineages in the bone marrow, and you don't see anything in the blood. You see only the last portion in the peripheral blood, that is the granulocytes, lymphocytes, and the red cell and the platelet, and everything arises in the bone marrow from the hematopoietic stem cell, and then they bifurcate into various lineages, and then the final developed product, it gets into the blood. Okay, next. So factors involved in hematopoiesis, just to refresh your memory, you need iron, B12, folic acid. Erythropoietin secreted by the kidney is a hormone which stimulates the erythropoiesis, and you need thyroxine, androgen. You know, definitely people have got hyperactivity, you will be anemic. So androgen is essential. You know, thyroid is essential. Hormones are all essential. They all affect the different stages in the bone marrow in the various nuclear transcription factors. Next slide. So based on the hemoglobin, men less than 13 is anemia, women less than 11.5, and some people say 12. And for newborn, you know, they all initially they have a compensatory high hemoglobin. So you have to have that level of hemoglobin for the newborn. So less than 15 will be anemia. And then as the age goes by, they all drop. And in puberty, it will be low. And then again, it picks up to 11 gram. Then as you come to adult, it should come to 13 gram. So, but let's not worry about that. I mean, we'll talk about adult men and women. And the newborn, of course, Indira is a neonatologist, she will know. Initially, it will be very high. And then it comes down. So, 3 months to 1 year, if it's just that 9.5, it is anemia. And from 1 year to puberty, less than 11 is anemia. Then it picks up. Next one. So, what are the questions I ask whenever I see a patient with anemia? I make it as practical as possible. The first thing you should look at the MCV. Most of us, you know, now we get generated reports from the machine. It has MCV, you should just have a mind to look at the MCV. Then reticulocyte count, but that is very difficult to get because it's a very basic test, but it is highly technician dependent. So most of the time, you know, they may not do it properly. So you should ask for a proper lab for a reticulocyte count. Then the red cell distribution width. How uniform or ununiform is the red cell? Is it isolated anemia or pancytopenia? Are there any other systemic disease? Like patient could have diabetes, renal failure, liver disease, rheumatoid problem, ulcerative colitis, anything. And what are the inflammatory markers like ESR, C-reactive protein? And LDH is a very, very important test. I use it very often. Very basic, simple screening test. It cannot be specific, but very sensitive to various disease conditions. Next. So the working diagnosis is it a disease of production or destruction? That is, you won't produce at all for various causes. Or it may be produced and then outside it comes and gets destroyed. So this is the basic, these are only the two basic root causes of anemia. Next. So the reticulocyte count is very important because the red cell, you know, has got 120 days lifespan. So whatever you see in the peripheral blood, it could be anything from day 0 to day 120. So you don't know what happened yesterday or day before yesterday. For that you need the reticulocyte count. So reticulocyte count will tell you, because they are freshly produced red cells. whether the production is good or bad. Based on the red cell count, you may not be able to assess, because it has got a, the red cell has got a long lifespan. So the patient may be having a problem which had happened just yesterday, but he would have had a circulating red cell which is which is already there, which was produced 3 months back. So you need to know the production is switched off or is still going on. So for that you need the reticulocyte count, which is just a young baby, is a baby red cell. So based on that you will be able to assess the production is there or not there. Next. And so in the disorder, if the red cell is destroyed, like acute blood loss or hemolysis, the retic will be very high, because the production is not a problem. It gets destroyed, so there is a compensation. So there is a brisk reticulocytosis. So this is all basic of what we learned in physiology in the second year. Next. So the reticulocyte expressed as a percentage of red cells or as an absolute number. Absolute number is always preferable, because the percentage is based only on the percentage is based on the red cell number. So if there is an anemia, the red cell number also will come down. The denominator also will come down. So both numerator and denominator will come down. So the percentage will be constant. So you should base your reticulocyte interpretation on absolute number, and nowadays there are some modern machines which also gives you the absolute number of the reticulocyte. Otherwise you have to apply a correction for the hemoglobin. So this is the basic reticulocyte, which is actually the RNA in the red cell, which is detected with the supravital stain, like methylene blue, that's the one thing which is used for the reticulocyte staining. And this is how you see the methylene blue, and in the peripheral smear you see a polychromatic cell, that is a blue cell. So if you see a blue cell, that is a young red cell or a reticulocyte. So if you have high polychromasia, that means there is a lot of reticulocyte in the peripheral blood. Next. So the red cell distribution, you see how uniform is the red cell size. It is supposed to be uniform. If it is very very variant in size, that is there is some abnormality in the production. What we call is anisocytosis. So change in the size is anisocytosis, change in the shape is phyclocytosis. Both are not good. So you need to have some uniformity. Next. And this is how, if it is a red cells of unequal size, so that means the red cell distribution width, this is a mathematical calculation, which is really very high. You can just allow a normal variation of 5 to 10%. Next. And normal peripheral smear, you see uniform red cells. And so the production disorder of erythropoiesis could be either isolated anemia, or it can be associated with other cell count problem, pancytopenia or a bicytopenia. Next. So isolated anemia, and you have a low reticulocyte count or even a normal reticulocyte count. If you have a patient with anemia, even a normal reticulocyte count is abnormal. That means it is inappropriate. If the production is good, you should have a very high reticulocyte count, like a hemolytic anemia. So this is the picture where you see an isolated anemia with a normal or low reticulocyte count. You have nutritional deficiency, anemia of chronic disease, renal disease, and ineffective erythropoiesis due to myelodysplasia. Next. Then the MCV. So you should look at the MCV. You should have the reticulocyte count and the mean corpuscular volume, whether it's a microcytic hypochromic or a normocytic or a macrocytic anemia. Next. So the microcytic and macrocytic anemia, you will just very easy. The normocytic anemia is more difficult. Next. So my MCV less than 80 is a microcytic anemia. 80 to 95 is normal. So next time when you get a blood count, please look at the MCV. That will tell you a lot. Next. So the pediatric population, if you have low MCV anemia, mostly is iron deficiency in our part of the country. But if you go up north, you should also think of thalassemia, which is quite rampant there. In our state, it is not that common. Next. In adult population, if you see a low MCV, the first is iron deficiency, and sometimes anemia of chronic disease can also manifest as a microcytic anemia. Next. So the pathogenesis of iron deficiency is because the iron stores get depleted. You already have stores. The first stage is depletion of iron stores. Then the anemia develops. So by the time you develop anemia, you can be 100% sure there is no iron store at all. Next. So the etiology could be nutritional or increased demand like pregnancy, lactation, chronic blood loss, failure of absorption. when these are all simple things. Next. Clinical features of iron deficiency will be esophageal rub, dysphagia, chironychia, spooning of the nail, and angular stomatitis. Next. So diagnosis is by examining the peripheral blood fluid. You see the microcytic hypochromic anemia. Serum ferritin is the best screening test. Serum ferritin is always reduced in iron deficiency anemia. See, then the rest are all, it could be subjective. Serum transferrin is supposed to be raised in iron deficiency. Low transferrin saturation and iron binding capacity is increased. Iron binding capacity is nothing but an indirect measurement of the transferrin. Because iron is bound to transferrin and it circulates. In iron deficiency, the serum ferritin, ferritin is a storage form of iron, it goes down. That's the most important test. Serum ferritin will be reduced, transferrin, that is the transport protein, gets raised and the saturation goes down. And the iron binding capacity, that is, it has a lot of capacity to bind iron. So it goes up. So this is the classical scenario. But if you ask me one test which I use in practice, is the serum ferritin. But that is the most important test. I tell you why when you come to anemia of chronic disease. Next. So the best marker of iron deficiency will be serum ferritin. Low serum ferritin, it confirms iron deficiency. But the only issue is, you can have a situation where the ferritin can be high because it is an acute phase reactant, but still the patient can be iron deficient. So that will be the problem. That very difficult to solve. So that is a patient with rheumatoid arthritis or ulcerative colitis or a chronic tuberculosis, they can have a high serum ferritin and they can also have a coexisting iron deficiency. To solve that may be a little bit of a problem. Next. So if you have a patient with iron deficiency, you should not leave it there. You should always look at the cause. So it could be gastrointestinal, genitourinary, nutritional. Of course, in women, you know, menorrhagia is very common. Nutritional is very common. Repeated, I mean, pregnancy, lactation, all that. And for adult men, you know, you cannot pass it off as simple. You should do an endoscopy or a colonoscopy or look for a genitourinary bleeding, blood loss. Next. So adult male iron deficiency in adult male should always prompt investigation for a GI blood loss. Look for occult blood in stools and refer for upper and lower GI endoscopy. Many times you have picked up CA colon or a CA stomach in an adult male. Of course in women you can be a little bit more liberal, especially when they are menstruating or if they had a the pregnancy, lactation, all that. Next. So anemia of chronic disease is another big problem in the clinical practice because this also will confuse it many times. That is purely cytokine mediated. See, any inflammation, the cytokines go up. There is a cytokine, now there is another factor called hepcidin, that is an iron regulator hormone secreted by the liver. So that also goes up and that inhibits the iron transport. So iron is not utilized. So what is called is that? Functional iron deficiency. You will have iron, but the body will not be able to utilize the iron. So that is what happens in anemia of chronic disease, which is quite common in any of the chronic conditions, including diabetes mellitus, chronic kidney disease, liver disease, or any other inflammatory disease for that matter. Next. So what are the conditions that can cause anemia of any chronic inflammatory tuberculosis or cancer related, or anybody is having a chronic multiple infections, osteomyelitis, anything you mention, they all will have some degree of anemia, and it's because of the anemia of chronic disease, and that is purely cytokine mediated, and there you have a functional iron deficiency. Next, and this is just a pictorial representation, purely based because of the cytokine, and there is a lot of disturbance to the iron metabolism, and in the bottom line, the iron is not able to be utilized. That's what happens. Next. So, how do you diagnose anemia of chronic disease? You could have mild microcytic anemia, microcytic, because anemia, iron is not utilized. And the ferritin will go up. It is an acute phase reactant. Raised ESR, raised ferritin, and the transferrin can go down. So, the transferrin saturation can be a clue. It can be normal to slightly low, not so low as iron deficiency. But you will always have a confusion, what if the patient also has an iron deficiency? So in that situation, you may have to apparently give some iron replacement and see whether the patient improves or, I mean, we don't have the facility God has got a transferrin receptor that is very, very sensitive assay. The transferrin receptor will be very high in iron deficiency anemia because the body wants iron. Whereas it is normal in or low in anemia of chronic disease, but that is not available in the routine clinical practice. So you have to rely upon your clinical judgment, or you can perhaps use some transferrin saturation level, or you just give some empirical iron, or you can do a bone marrow and look for iron stores. But that is an invasive procedure. Next. So anemia of raised ESR always a concern. So it will be anemia of chronic disease, lymphoma, or multiple myeloma. It's quite common in your day-to-day practice. I mean, many times patient comes with anemia and raised ESR, and we do the serum electrophoresis. They have an abnormal serum monoclonal protein. Next. So thalassemia is another microcytic anemia, but there is an iron overload disorder. The ferritin will be very high. So serum ferritin is very high as opposed to iron deficiency, and peripheral blood picture will be grossly abnormal with a lot of microcytes. Next. The normocytic normochromic anemia is difficult. That is, anemia of chronic disease can either manifest as normocytic normochromic or mild to microcytic, renal disease, marrow infiltration diseases, marrow failure. So it's a big basket. So it is very difficult to sort it out unless you have a clear history, or sometimes you may have to do a bone marrow examination. Next. Macrocytic anemia is a problem. We saw microcytic anemia, normocytic. Macrocytic could be easy to solve. So MCV more than 95, as I told you, normal is 80 to 95. So the commonest cause will be B12 folate deficiency, hypothyroidism, alcoholism. If the patient is exposed to cytotoxic drugs, pregnancy can slightly elevate MCV. Myelodysplastic syndrome, this is quite common in elderly people, and any marrow failure disorders. Actually, macrocytic anemia could be more sinister than microcytic anemia. And B12 deficiency is a curable condition. So you should, whenever you see a patient with macrocytic anemia, the first thing I do is a B12 level. So it's formed only in animal produce. And a pure vegan definitely will develop a B12 deficiency. It's absorbed in ileum, and you need intrinsic factor help to absorb the B12. Next. And nutritional in people who are malnourished, deprived, chronic atrophic gastritis, nowadays you call autoimmune gastritis, where you need the intrinsic factor that is lacking, and pernicious anemia is part of that, and food cobalamin malabsorption quite bad, and people who have got an ileal resection. So whenever you do a gastrectomy or an ileal resection, you should always retest them with B12. Again, it's very important for surgeons. When you could do a gastrectomy or an ileal resection, you should replace them with B12. Yes. Pernicious anemia is an autoimmune condition. Autoimmune condition, it usually affects the elderly person, and it is an antibody to parietal cell or an intrinsic factor antibody. And that is the most common cause of B12 deficiency if you eliminate the nutritional cause. Next. So clinical picture, they can have pallor, uterus, glossitis, swollen tongue, neuropathy. They will have tingling sensation in the feet and in the hand. Next. Typically, they have macrocytic anemia. Hypersegmented neutrophil is a takeaway. So if you look at the peripheral film, you see hypersegmented neutrophil. And there is a classical finding in a B12 deficiency. And LDH will be very high in macrocytic B12 deficiency, because there is an intramedullary hemolysis, and it can present as a pancytopenia. So the diagnosis is by red cell, doing a serum B12 level, and you can also do red cell folate. And if you have a facility, you can ask for anti-parietal cell antibody, and the plasma homocysteine will be elevated in B12 deficiency. And you can do an endoscopy for an atrophic gastritis. Next. And typical hypersegmented neutrophil in B12 deficiency. Next. So summary, approach to macrocytic anemia, examine the blood film, think of B12 deficiency, other macro causes of macrocytosis like liver function tests, alcohol history, hypothyroidism, and drugs like anticonvulsants. But you should do a serum B12 level. Next. So anemia can also be part of the pancytopenia, like megaloblastic anemia or marrow infiltrative disorder or a marrow infiltration. Next. So then we go to the next topic, there is anemia of increased reticulocyte count, in just few minutes. Hemolytic anemia is the most important cause. Next. And this accelerated red cell destruction. And if you have elevated reticulocyte count, elevated LDH, indirect hyperbilirubinemia, and reduced plasma haptoglobin. This is classical hemolytic anemia. Next. And it could be immune or non-immune, intravascular or extravascular. Next. So autoimmune hemolytic anemia is diagnosed by a positive direct Coombs test. And other causes will be hereditary spherocytosis, G6PD deficiency or microangiopathic hemolysis. So basically remember, if you have anemia with a high reticulocyte count, you should look for hemolytic anemia. Next. So there is no one substitute for a good peripheral smear. Next. This is a normal peripheral smear. Next. Next. So is this, you see a clear autoimmune hemolytic anemia, lot of blue cells, that is reticulocytosis, and spherocytes, that is cells without a central pallor. If you see this, this is a classical case of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. You ask for a direct Coombs test. Next, next. And this is an oxidative hemolysis, you see bite cell or a blister cell, which is classical of G6PD deficiency. And another important cause is fragmentary hemolysis, where the red cells get fragmented. That is a microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. This is sickle cell. This is a, then sometimes we have detected leukemia in the blood. This is a sickle blast or a myeloblast. Next, next. So when to develop for a bone marrow study, maybe I will skip this. Whenever you can't solve the problem of anemia, you refer to a hematologist. Where you do the serum ferritin, B12, look at the peripheral smear, look at the renal function. If everything is normal, if you don't have any idea, then you refer to a hematologist. Then he may need a bone marrow biopsy, he or she. Next. And this is a normal bone marrow. Next. And this is an aplastic marrow, complete pancytopenia. Next. This is a, one of the cases where he had a hypocellular marrow. So treatment decision, find out the cause, supportive and specific treatment. So iron replacement, if you, seconds, oral iron is always the best. If the patient cannot tolerate oral iron, you resort to IV iron. And these are the good preparations are nowadays available without much side effect. Anemia of chronic disease, treat the cause. Sometimes you can give erythropoietin. Megaloblastic anemia, give a B12 replacement, but it has to be for life. If you don't tell them for life, they will come back again. So take home points, last slide. Look at the MCV, look at the reticulocyte count, look at the ESR, do serum LDH and ferritin, liver function, renal function, look for other blood counts. Ask for a good peripheral blood smear, that is the most difficult. You can get a PET CT or a MRI or anything I find, but good peripheral smear, even today is difficult, I can tell you. And even a good reticulocyte count is difficult. And do a bone marrow only after looking at the peripheral blood film. Don't do bone marrow without that step. All cases of anemia is not iron deficiency. And most of the anemia can be sorted out with simple basic tests. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna. Can I request Dr. Anamale to handle the again?